Christ living undivided right.
You need a strong east wind. You need a strong east wind to blow out your preconceived ideas. You need a strong east wind to blow out your religion. You need a strong east wind to blow out the doctrine of the scribes and Pharisees, which still possess your soul because you've not allowed the Holy Ghost to move in you and set you free.
A ministry with a vision. A ministry on the move. A ministry established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Think what God wants to do in his people is make his supernatural Holy Ghost fire and power clear to our sight, clear to our mind, so that there is no doubt in our spiritual creation who God is.
Bible for Christ Love International Ministry, a ministry with a vision built on a plan. God.
Some people coming in, it's going to be good. Yes. So right now, here is Apostle Jenny to open today's service in prayer.
Amen. All right, who's ready for church? All right, so I know that we're not going to be stuck in the pews today. I'm pretty certain we're all going to be getting crazy in the spirit, running around here. All right, I want you to grab somebody's hand. Let's stand up and give some honor to the Lord as we open up in prayer this morning. And I'm happy, we're so happy to see your smiling face and wonderful hearts today. All right, let's lift up our hands to the Lord. Father, we glorify your name this morning. Lord, as a people, we magnify your greatness. We ask today that you open up the heavens of heaven and begin to pour out your glory. Father, pour out a blessing that we cannot contain. Father, we ask, overflow us with your anointing. Let us be caught up in the river of what you have called for this day and this hour and this season. Let your hearts cry out this morning. Father, we thank you. And as a whole church, we say amen and amen.
Praise God. All right, let's everybody lift up our hands, lift up our hearts. Let's praise and worship the Lord on this beautiful Sunday morning. Let's praise and worship the Lord. Here is Prophetess Sandra to lead our praise team.
Jesus. Oh, we praise you, Lord. Father, we give you all the glory and all the praise. Hallelujah. How many of you are ready for the Holy Ghost? Oh, to take control this day. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Fresh oil is flowing.
Hallelujah.
The comforter is close.
Oh, yeah.
This revelation feeling is called the Holy Ghost. It's fresh and refreshing. It's heavenly power. This encore of Pentecost is happening this hour.
Let it fall on me. Let it fall on me.
Let it fall.
Let the Holy Ghost and fire fall on me.
Let it fall. Let it fall.
Let it fall on me.
Oh yes, Lord.
Let it fall on me. Let the Holy Ghost and fire fall on me.
The bridegroom is coming. Let's rise up a shout. It's the upper room spirit that the King is pouring out.
your time. Renew me with new touch. Revive me with new wine. Baptize me with fresh fire. This is my time. This is my time. Renew me with new touch. Revive me with new wine. Baptize me with fresh fire. This is your time. This is your time. I can feel it in my hands. I can feel it in my feet. It's the Holy Ghost and fire. It's all over me.
Oh, yeah.
I can feel it in my head.
I can feel it.
I can feel it in my feet.
I can feel it.
It's the Holy Ghost and fire. It's all over me.
Oh, yeah. Holy Ghost.
I can feel it in my hands.
Holy Ghost.
I can feel it in my feet.
The requirements.
It's the Holy Ghost.
It's your
fire.
Requirement.
All over me.
Surrender, surrender.
I can feel it in my hands.
Surrender, surrender.
I can feel it in my feet.
Let it consume you.
It's the Holy Ghost and fire.
It's all we need.
It's the Holy Ghost and fire. It's all over me.
All over me.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. I stand here today and I thank the Lord. For there was once a time in my life that I didn't have that fire in my life. I didn't have the Holy Ghost. But we thank the Lord this day that He has given us the power to overcome the lies of the enemy. He's given us the power to overcome and override our carnal mind. He has given us the power to say no to our flesh and say no to lustful desires. If you need healing, there is power in the blood of Jesus. There is power in the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. And I pray today that that fire, that the Holy Ghost would be released through this sanctuary. I can feel it in my hands. Oh, yes.
I can feel it.
I can feel it in my feet.
It in my feet. It's the Holy Ghost and fire.
Oh, yes. Sing it.
All over me.
Oh, I want it. I want it.
I can feel it in my head.
I want the Holy Ghost.
I can feel it in my feet.
Oh, yes.
It's the Holy Ghost and fire all over me. I can feel it in my head.
I want to feel it, Lord.
I can feel it in my feet.
I want you to take control.
It's the Holy Ghost and fire all over me.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I can feel it in my head. I can feel it in my feet. It's the Holy Ghost and fire.
Oh, yes. And it's all over me. Oh, yes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give you the highest praise. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. When I heard Apostle Jenny preach last Sunday, all I could think about was this song. And I know she talked about mantles, but in her message, intertwined in there, it brought me back to remembering the moments that I cried out to God, the moments of passion where I
didn't let anything stop me. A lot of those moments I was by myself. A lot of those moments I felt like a whirlwind around me. A lot of those moments I knew that man could not help me. All I knew was to fall down on my knees and to sincerely cry out with a hunger and passion. And I sat there and cried, and I sought the face of God, and I sought the face of Jesus, and I let the Holy Ghost enter into that room, and I didn't move until I felt His presence. Oh, He longs for you to be in that place of passion, where you won't let nothing stop you. You won't let anything keep you. You'll run to Him and you won't look at anything else but Him, His eyes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He wants you. He wants your heart. Oh.
There's gonna be a way.
Hallelujah.
It's the reason I'm living.
That's the reason why I live.
To marry the Lamb.
Oh, yes.
Oh, there's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb. Oh, there's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb.
That's all I want.
Oh, there's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb.
Oh, yeah.
Gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb.
That's all I want.
There's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb.
Oh yes, Lord. To be one with you.
I love you.
That's all I want, Lord.
My legs are shaking and my hands are cold, but I see your eyes and my heart grows bold. My legs are shaking and my hands are cold, but I see your eyes and my heart grows bold.
Oh, yeah.
And my legs are shaking.
Oh, yes,
and my hands are cold.
My hands are cold.
But I see your eyes and my heart grows bold. My legs are shaking.
Oh, yeah.
My hands are cold.
We want you,
and I see your eyes, and my heart grows bold. There's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb. Oh, there's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, there's gonna be a wedding. It's the reason I'm living. To marry the Lamb. walk with my lover. I'm gonna walk with my lover.
Oh, yes.
Hand in hand, heart in heart.
Yes.
I'm gonna walk with my lover.
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 I'm gonna walk with my lover. Hand in hand, heart in heart. Oh, I'm gonna walk with my lover.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I'm gonna walk with my lover.
I'm gonna walk with my lover.
I'm gonna walk with my lover. Hand in hand, heart in heart. I'm gonna walk with my Lord.
That's all I want, Lord.
I'm gonna walk with my Lord.
I'm gonna walk with my Lord.
I'm gonna walk with my Lord. Hand in hand, heart in heart.
Oh, yeah.
I'm gonna walk. I'm gonna walk with my Lord.
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 Hand in hand, heart in heart. There's gonna be a wedding.
Oh, yes.
That's the reason I'm living.
That's the reason I live on.
To be one with you, Lord. There's gonna be a wedding. Oh, I want
the
Lord.
That's the reason I'm living.
I want you
to marry the
to be one with you. Oh, yeah.
He's waiting for a bride.
Oh, yeah.
He's waiting for a bride.
He is waiting.
He's waiting for a bride.
Oh, yeah.
Fill up your lamp. Fill up your lamp. He's waiting,
oh, yeah,
for a bride.
Oh, yeah.
He's waiting for a bride. He's waiting for a bride. Fill up your lamp. Fill up your lamp. He's waiting for a bride. He's waiting for a bride.
Raise your hand if you feel that presence of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. We thank you, God. The Bible says, quench not the Spirit of God. Let His Spirit move through you and in your temple. Let the Spirit of God come alive in the house of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Right now, our Winds of Fire flag worship team. This morning, this is February, our Women's Month. where we give the Lord all the glory and exaltation, and we love to highlight the mantles and the callings that God has upon women in their lives. And this morning, I want to welcome all the visitors in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you, Mario. I hope when I grow up, I can do the flags like Mario. I'm still working on it. Somehow I'm not quite yet there, but they do amazing. I want to welcome everybody in the house of the Lord. We are so happy that you are here with the family of God. And I know that the Lord has something great in store for you. You know, the Bible tells us it is blessed and better when the saints of God come into the house of God more ready to give than to receive. And I've thought about that my entire walk with the Lord. And I think of how we come in sometimes and we're just like, oh, it's so bad. I just need God to answer my problem. But what about coming into the house of God? I'm ready to give you the glory today. I'm ready to offer up the sacrifice of praise and worship. I'm ready to embrace my brother and my sister with a Holy Ghost hug. So do that right now. Embrace your brother and your sister with a Holy Ghost hug. Come on. Come on, get it in there. Get it in there. Yeah, glory. I love the family of God. You know what happens when we do that? Mara's going to teach me how to do those flags. And I'll teach him how to do the silks. Fair trade. And we're happy to have Brother Ryan back with us and Brother Tommy. But you know what happens when we embrace each other with the Holy Ghost hug? You see, the Jesus in me and the Spirit in me is now released on you. And the Jesus in you and the light in you is now released upon your brother and your sister. And that's a good thing. Amen? All right, let's stand up to our feet this morning. It's my great privilege and honor, and I've been excited about this woman of God speaking today all month, because I know there's a message stirring inside of her. I've known her well over 30 years. She's one of my best friends, and I can tell you beyond the shadow of a doubt, she walks what she prophesies. She's a woman of great spiritual integrity. Give the Lord the hand. It is my honor and my privilege to introduce this morning Revival for Christ Club's own prophetess, Sandra Cardenas.
Amen, amen. Well, I'm excited to be here today. I'm excited to stand behind the pulpit again. I'm thankful to the Lord for what he's done. And I just want, before I do anything, I'm going to start in prayer. But before I do that, when I get behind the pulpit, I always have to give honor back to the ones who taught me, who the ones who trained me, who the ones who fed me, who the ones who counseled me, who the ones that corrected me. Yes. And that is Apostle Jennifer and Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover. And I want to make sure when you heard that, I said all of those things, because all of those things are important and have happened in my life. Yes. I've been taught. I've been corrected.
Yes.
I've been instructed. I've been all those things. And if there's anything good that comes out, I give God all the glory. Because I was once a lost little girl. And I thank God for saving me. I thank God that I gave my life to Jesus. I thank him. I thank him that he heard my prayer when I told him I needed more. And he put me in the path of Revival for Christ Club.
Yes.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord, for those things. So if you'd like, I know a lot of y'all are standing, but if you'd like to, those that are not, if you can, if you would like to go ahead and stand up to your feet, we're going to pray to get into the Word of God. I'm excited to share what the Lord has spoken to me today. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we humbly approach you. Father, with honor, with praise, Father, we just love you. And we thank you, Father, even for the opportunities that you give us to come and to hear your divine word. Father, for I know in myself, Lord, that if there's anything that comes out that brings refreshment, that brings joy, that brings strength to the people of God, I know it comes from you and not me. And I pray right now, Father, put that coal in my mouth and let me speak your word. Let me speak it as you have given it to me, God. Oh, and Holy Ghost, you take control. Holy Ghost, you have your way. Let everything in me. Oh, yes. Let everything in me be put to silence. Oh, yes, that the Holy Ghost will take control. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I thank you. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for everything you do in this ministry. Thank you for the men and women of God who have humbled themselves and have poured out to many people. I even pray that you refresh them and strengthen them. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. I know that was a little bit of a different prayer, but it's okay. I love the Lord and I love his word as much as I love the Holy Ghost. And believe me, I love the Spirit of God. I love to be lost in the presence of God. I love to just sit there and bask in his presence. But without the word of God, it does me no good. I have to have instruction for my life. I have to have that meat that will sustain me. And I realize that that meat does not come from what I think or what I can come up with, but it comes from submitting myself to the Lord and seeking and searching for his riches in the word of God. And I just love the word of God. I get so lost in the word of God. You know, it's funny because whenever I putting a message together, it's like a spider web and it can go so many ways. And I'm starting on this subject and I'm way over here and I'm like, oh Lord, wait a minute, I'm studying this. But that's how much I love the word of God, that I just see all these connections. I'm like, oh God, I get so excited. Hallelujah. Well, let's go ahead and get into the word of God. And what I'm going to talk about today, you know, we all have heard what the subject is for this month and what we're concentrating on. And what we've been talking about is getting back to the basics of servitude of God, of who we are. And one of the things, and I had two or three messages that I was working on, and I felt real strongly about one. And then after Apostle Jenny preached last Sunday, I know it was about mentorship, but for some reason there were things that she said in that message, it just caught my attention and brought me back into remembrance of those moments in my life where I wanted nothing else but God. I wanted nothing else but to find him. And you know, we can say, well, we're Christians, we found our Savior. Yes, but sometimes in the course of life, and sometimes even when you're serving God, you get lost in all the responsibilities. You get lost in all the things that distract you, and you forget your first love. Yes. You forget that moment, that encounter that happened at the altar. You forget those things because we get so caught up in everything going around that we don't stop and seek and pray and cry out to God and get a singleness of vision to keep our eyes on Jesus and to realize that the life I have, every breath that I take, every moment that I live, it's because of him and should give him honor and glory. So I'm going to talk about his passion. Passion. to have passion in your life. What will you do to get close to God? What are you willing to give up? What are you willing to sacrifice? What are you willing to put to the side to get closer with Him? And sometimes those things are on a daily basis, because see, daily we can get distracted. Daily we can put things before God. Daily we get busy about our life. And I'm telling you, sometimes I have to watch myself, because that happens to me all the time. I'm a mother of three children. Now they're getting older and I can sit back a little bit with them, but still get so caught up in the to-do, that we forget about that encounter that we had with God. So the Lord began to speak to me, and I'm going to share. There's a couple of stories, and I'm just going to be led by the Spirit of God. I know I have a lot more than I'll be able to deliver, and I'm not worried about that, because I know as long as I'm riding that wave of the Holy Ghost, as long as I'm sensitive to the Spirit of God, I'll deliver what He has for me to deliver today. But I want to start off with, and I found this interesting, because as Apostle Jenny was preaching, and I was thinking about passion, this story popped in my head, and I'm like, out of all the stories in the Bible, this is a very small passage that is in the Word of God. But yet when I sat there and I meditated on it, I just couldn't get over it. And so we're going to start in Luke chapter 2. And I just love what it says here. We're going to talk about the prophetess Anna. And there's not much written in there. But when I thought, and it's funny because I was there and I was just thinking about, after that message on Sunday, it just stayed with me about passion, passion, passion. And the Lord reminded me of her. And I thought, well, I'm going to go read it. And so this is what it says in Luke chapter 2. Excuse me. In Luke chapter 2, and we're going to start in 36. And we're going to take it slow, because I want to bring out some details about this. Because see, if we read the story, it's done in like 2 seconds, because there's not much there about her. But before we get there, Jesus had just been born. And so Joseph and Mary were getting ready to present him into the temple. And so this is where we're at in the story. And if you go up, there's also, it talks about another man there in the temple that I find very interesting. Anna the prophetess, I find extremely interesting. And there's many details to her. And I love to pay attention to the details in the story. But in 36 it says, and there was one Anna the prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Aser. She was of great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And she was a widow of about 84 years, which departed not from the temple, but served God with fasting and prayer night and day. And so right there, it paints a picture of who prophetess Anna was. First of all, it says that she lived with her husband for 7 years. She was married to a husband, and she was a virgin when she married him. Yes. And she was with him for 7 years. And then after 7 years, he passed away. And then it says that after that time, she went into the temple of God, and she served there 84 years. Now, it doesn't say that's her age, because she was married to him 7 years, and then she went to the temple and was there 84 years. That's 84 years. Now, talk about passion. I started thinking about this. She was a virgin and married this man, and she was married to him for 7 years, and then he passed away. She never looked for another love. She never focused on anything else. She never went out searching for love. The only place she went was to the temple. And you think about it. What was her title? What? She's a prophet. What do prophets do? Huh? What do? We give direction, but also what do? We prophesy. We prophesy. So I want you to think about this. She's a prophet. She was married for only 7 years. And she was a virgin. So that tells me a lot about her. She was a very pure woman. She was a prophet. She was married to only one man. That reminds me of Romans 7. When it talks about that you're married to one, but then when you separate, you got to be married to another, and that's Jesus. But here in this story, she's a virgin. She's been married once. He passes away, and she's in that temple 84 years. And I'm like, kept on telling Abel, 84. I love how it says it in there. I just love how the description says it. And the only thing, so now let's go ahead and paint this picture. Prophetess. And you think about this. 84 years, never looked for another love. Talk about passion.
That's passion.
What was she doing in the temple? It says that she was fasting and praying. Well, I'm pretty sure she was prophesying.
Yeah.
And guess who she was prophesying about? She probably for 84 years, she prophesied about the man that was going to come and become the new husband to the church. She was prophesying about the Messiah for 84 years. Can you imagine having nothing else that she focused on, but she prayed and fasted and waited for Jesus to be born. Now you think about that. Wait a minute. 84 years before Jesus was born. Because when Jesus was born, she was there at the temple waiting for him to come in. And I think, my God, that is passion. She prophesied and prayed and fasted. And you think about that 84. All I could think about was the four images of the new creation. She was prophesying that we would connect back to God and that we could bear his image, that we could bear the image of Jesus, our Savior, and to have the Holy Ghost inside of us. Remember back in that day, the Holy Ghost wasn't inside of them. It would fall upon them. She waited for Jesus to be born. 84 years. 84 years before he even stepped in the room. And then when he did, she went right up to him. And even this description here tells you what she did and what she probably did those 84 years. In 38 it says, and she coming in that instant, and this is okay, now she's coming. Now what this is saying is now they've brought Jesus into the temple. Mary and Joseph were coming and presenting Jesus at the temple. So now she's responding and she's reacting to them bringing him in. And it says, and she coming in that instance gave thanks likewise unto the Lord and spake of him to all them that looked for redemption in Jerusalem. She went and she told them, there is redemption on the way. There is redemption on the way. And see, she was focused. She was passionate about God that she waited for the Savior to be born just to see him. Just to see him. I see that. I read this story and I thought, my God, that is passion. That is passion to wait 84 years and not put any other love before herself. Not looking to anything else to fall in love with. See, and that's wrong with the church today. We have so many loves. We love things that we don't want to let go of. We hold on to things because we think they're important or they add to us. The only thing, if it's not of God, the only thing it adds is to your flesh. The very separator of you and God is your flesh and your carnal mind. The very thing that keeps you from marrying the one, the Lamb of God. She waited. She had passion enough not to fall in love with anything else, but waited for him 84 years. Sometimes we can't even wait a little bit. We can't wait to get out of church now. We can't wait for something else to happen. Amen. The very thing that's going to give you life and change you is right here.
That's right.
This. You can have all the moves you want. You can have all the moves you want. But if it's not grounded in the Word of God, it's not going to do you any good, because you're just going to float away in the air. You have to be established in that Word of God. That's why it's so important. Stay focused on God. Don't let anything get in your way. Will you be passionate in love enough to fall in love with Him and not let anything come between you and Him? And we can say, yes, God, I will do that. But on a daily basis, we put things in front of Him. We let things block us from touching Him. We put things there that hinder us from getting close to Him. And it's not God that does it. It's me and you that do it. We're the ones that cut ourselves short. Because the Bible said He's always there. God is always speaking to His people. We just have to have the ear to hear. So that is one encounter that I found about passion. That 84 just got me. She was praying for that reconciliation, for that redemption to take place. She waited. And she didn't wait and be silent. Have you ever seen a prophet that's silent? Nope. We're loud. We're loud and we're bold and we speak. So I can imagine what she did. I can just imagine her saying, God, send your Savior. Send Him, Lord. We're waiting. We're waiting for You. And I'm sure everybody in the temple heard her glorifying God, heard her lifting up the name of Jesus, heard her crying out to God for redemption. She prophesied redemption. She prayed for redemption. And then when she saw Jesus, she went and told people about it. That is passion. That is having a singleness of vision, not letting any other love come before her. But now here's another story. We'll go to our next example. Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5. So here's another example of passion, totally different situation, totally different circumstances going on here. And this happens a lot. So we have that one woman, the prophetess, that kept her mind, kept herself, made sure she stayed pure. You know, it talks about that 7, and that talks about the perfection. She walked with that. She was a virgin. She was clean. She was kept her mind on God for 84 years. But here you have another situation where we find a lot of people. We find a lot of times we as people get so caught up in somebody else helping us. Instead of letting God, instead of letting the Lord heal us, restore us, counsel us, we try to fix ourselves. Or we waste all our resources on people that cannot help us. A lot of times that's what we do. We waste all our resources, or we pour out ourselves to people that cannot help us. A lot of times we do that with friends. And that happens a lot. We communicate and we tell our friends what's going on in our life, and that's okay if you want to talk about it. But then if the friend becomes a counselor or tries to counsel or gives you advice, you better make sure that you're hearing godly ears, because a kind heart cannot always bring true healing. A lot of times a kind heart looks at the outward and makes decisions based on the outward, or looks maybe for to make things better for you in that situation. You know what? A lot of times when you're going through a hard time, those are signs that you need counsel. If you keep on bumping into the same wall and you keep on running into the same thing, God is trying to get your attention that you need to seek God. You need to seek counsel. And here's the problem that people have with counsel. Because counseling requires you to go to a man. And we don't want to do that. And see, that teaches us humbleness. If you go to a counselor that is engulfed in the Word of God, that is led by the Spirit of God, that their mouth has fire in it, I assure you that when the counsel comes forth, it'll bring life in you. And it might not be the way you like it, but as long as it produces spiritual life, it's good. As long as it produces spiritual strength, it is good. And that's a lot of times what we don't. But in this story, this is the woman with the issue of blood. And she had this issue for 12 years. Totally different from the other situation. The other one stayed in the temple, fasted and prayed for 85 years, kept herself seeking God, praying for God, praying that he would send the Savior, prophesying. I'm sure everybody around her heard all the prophecies. This woman over here was ill. And she went to all the doctors that she could think of. It says that she went and spent everything she had to get healing. And it says that they used her and she didn't get better. She used all her resources. She used everything she had to get fixed, to get healing. And nothing happened. And it says here, the situation changed when she met up with Jesus. In Mark chapter 5 and verse 25, it says, "And a certain woman which had an issue of blood for 12 years had suffered many things of many physicians and had spent all she had and was nothing better but rather grew worse." And I'm telling you, you can kind of see this sometimes in people where you're sitting back thinking, man, if you only would just surrender. And you see a hurting soul and it seems like they're just going in a circle like a whirlwind, but they won't listen to you. All you need is an encounter at the altar. All you need to do is touch that hem of his garment. That's all it took for her. See, but at this moment, it's describing her situation and where she was at. And where she was at was she was seeking help from others that could not give it to her, but made her worse. And see, as long as you seek help from those that are not called in your life to give or provide health and healing to you, you will grow the worst. It will be made manifest in your life. You will see the ones that surrender to the Lord and surrender and submit themselves to the men and women of God because they long. See, if I'm going to just tell you this. Just share with you me, a piece of me. If I want to know if I did something right or wrong, I call Apostle Jenny. And I tell her what I've done. I've done that to Chief, too. One time I had a situation on praise, and I handled it a certain way, and I thought I did it right, but I was unsure. And I didn't wait till the story got back to him. The very moment that situation happened, I called him. And I said, this and this and this is what I have done. I don't know if I did it right. And he goes, nope, you didn't do it right. This is what you should have done. He taught me. Had I have not sought that, I never would have known. It increased in me. It brought wisdom to me. And see, we have to be passionate enough to desire the truth in our life. See, because I can go and tell somebody else what I think is right. But if I'm passionate enough, if I have that passion and desire to be obedient to the Lord and to grow and to learn, then I'm going to go to the sources that God has put before me for me to gain knowledge and to gain wisdom. And it says in 27, and when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said in 28, for she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be made whole. And see, she had given out all her resources. She had poured out to others, hoping to get healing. But here in this moment, she was passionate enough that even though she had that issue of blood, even though she spent all that she did and she was in turmoil and she was hurting and she was in health, healed, and she had all these issues going on and she felt used by the physicians, she was passionate enough to push through that and said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. In your despair, in your hurt, and in your problems, and whatever you face through the day, do you have passion enough to stop what you're doing and tell the Lord, if I can just touch the hem, if I can just touch the hem of your garment, I know that you will bring healing to me. I know that you can physically heal me and you can bring a spiritual healing to my soul. She was passionate enough. Even, see, a lot of times our attitude is, fleshly attitude is, well, I've already spent all that I had. I've already given it all away. I've already tried everything. So you know what? I hear Jesus is coming. But you know what? I've spent everything I had. I don't have nothing else. A lot of times our thoughts will pull us away from the healing that God's getting ready to do in our life. We need to have that passion. We have to be driven by that passion to touch that hem and to know that when we touch the hem, even just the hem of his garment, she didn't even touch him. It was the hem that laid on the ground as he walked. She was passionate enough just to reach out and just touch it. She didn't pull it. She didn't yank it away. She doesn't say that she pushed people away. She pressed in behind him. There was a crowd of people all around Jesus that were physically touching his body. And it made no impact on their life. But it was her touch. It was the touch of passion. It was the touch knowing I don't have anything else. There's nothing else I can do, God. All I want to do is just touch the hem as you step by and the crowd is around you and they're even trying to push me away from you. I will go to you and I will touch the hem, and when I do that, I know I can be made whole. She was passionate enough to do that. And what happened? happen. It says in verse 29, and it says, and straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up. And she felt in her body that she was healed from the plague. She felt healing run through her body. Have you ever stood at the altar and God touched you and you felt God touch you? It wasn't the man. It wasn't the woman. You know, when we come to the altar, that is a point. It is a place of surrender. It is a place where you cut off everything else and you focus on the love of Jesus, the love of God, the power of the Holy Ghost that is poured out. When you come to the altar, it is a place where you can get healing. It is a place where if you feel things in your life are being stirred up and you don't know what to do, come to the altar, pray and seek God. Even before church, see, passionate people will come early to church. Passionate people will try to get to the church house early so that they can hit the altars and pray that God would move. Pray that they would feel his presence. Pray that there would be healings. Pray that people, when they pass by, they'll feel the draw of the Spirit. See, but those things will only happen when there's people praying at the altar, coming and seeking the face of God. I don't know how many times I have come, and I've said this story many times, but it's a very important time in my life. When my mother was getting ready to pass away, I would come to the altar at 6:00, 6:15, whatever time we would get here. It was early. Church didn't start till 7:30. And I had responsibilities, but I came to the altar first. I never did anything without coming to the altar. I would cry to God. I would seek him. I see, that's the problem. We are people that have problems, that walk around with problems in our life, and we don't come to the altar and lay them at his feet. That's the problem. And see, we become so accustomed to carrying that weight, carrying those problems. We don't lay them down at the altar. But I tell you this, if you do that and you do it with all your heart, God will move. He will always be there for you. We are the ones that hold back from coming to the altar and seeing God move in a mighty way. God wants to move. He's always wanting to move. He's always wanting to fill you up. He's always wanting to touch you. But it is the people that have distanced themselves from God. We need to be people that hunger for God, and not just hunger to be moved, but hunger to be fed, hunger to sustain the word of God and keep it alive in our hearts, hungry so that we can manifest the image of Jesus in our lives. See, if we walk out of this place and we have that image of Jesus flowing through us, can you imagine the revival that will happen? It'll be when the people of God grab that hem and walk in that healing and let the image of Jesus shine through them, and it'll attract those that are searching and seeking. There are people all around you that need answers from God. They need a touch. They need healing in their mind. There are so many people that have mental issues right now. The people of God need to be praying for healing. They need to be praying for those that are sick. They need to be praying for those that walk around and do not have peace in their mind. That will all happen when we become passionate enough to lay down our life. Will you be passionate enough to do those things? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, yes, Lord. Hallelujah. In Matthew 16, we're going to talk about this one story. Matthew, if you'll go there, this is the one that first started this message. This is the first story that popped in my mind. And this one reminded me of a dream that I had. I had a dream many years ago. I'm sure it was before I had Marissa. It was very, very long time ago. And I was already married to Abel. And I had this dream. I want to share it with you because it reminds me of this passage. And it reminds me of that song that we used to sing, Into the Deep, I think is what it's called. And every time Andrew would sing that song, I would see this dream. And for all these years, Marissa's 18, so it's been over 20 years I've had this dream. Every time I think about this dream, my heart, I feel love. And this is what this dream was. I had a dream that me and Abel were on a ship. And it was like an old pirate ship. And so it was wood everywhere. And I remember in that dream, I was hugging Abel. And all of a sudden, we were just hugging. We were in our room, and there was a door. And then I could see a hallway. Our door was open, or had no physical door. It was just the opening. And then there was a hallway, and then there was another room with another door that was open. And in that room, way over there, there was a man laying on a bed. It looked like he was on a gurney. It looked like he was dead. And so I'm in my room, in our room, and I'm hugging Abel. When I'm hugging him, I see that man in that gurney. And as we're hugging, I feel this love I have never felt before. And I was just hugging Abel, but the love that I felt was not coming from Abel. It was coming from that man on the gurney. And the whole time I'm hugging Abel, I'm like, I've got to get to him. I love my husband. But in that moment, the love that was coming from that dead man was drawing me to him. And so the next thing, my dream changed. The next thing, I'm standing on the top of the deck. We're all on top. There was a lot of people. We're all on top of the deck of this boat. And again, it was all wood, pirate ship type. And so we're all standing in there, standing up there, a bunch of people. And we're in the middle of the ocean. And all of a sudden, here comes that man that was dead, but now he's alive. And I see him, and I'm like, who is he? And I watched them, and they caught him. And they brought him to the edge of the ship. And everybody was just looking. I'm like, no, no. I was telling him no. And they threw him in the deep water. And they threw him out. And I was just like, oh, my God. And all I could think of was him. Yet I was with my husband. And I thought, oh, my God. And then they drove the ship to the shore. And as the ship got to the shore, they threw all the people off the ship. But when we got thrown off, the water was barely hitting our ankles. We were at the shore. And I remember standing there, and all I could think about was the man that was way out in the ocean. And I was standing there, and I looked down, and there's sand. And I remember getting my hand and dipping it into the hand and picking it up. And when I did, there was a pearl in my hand. And I looked at the pearl. It was beautiful. But then it just dissolved itself and turned into sand. And then I turned around, and all I could think of was that man. And I thought, I've got to get to him. And I remember jumping back in the water, and I swam all the way. It was far. And I swam. And when I got to him, I threw my arms around him, and we hugged. And I woke up hugging him. And I felt a love like I've never felt before. I know that was Jesus. And see, we have to be passionate enough. That dream showed me passion. It showed me how to have passion for the Lord. That love, when you have love for something, it will drive you. But see, we have so many other loves. Peter in Matthew 14 and 22, was out on a boat with other disciples. Jesus had told them, they had just finished feeding the multitude, and Jesus sent them away. And he told them, it says in the Bible that Jesus constrained them to get in the boat. So Jesus told them, get in the boat. He commanded them to get in the boat. He put them in that boat. God knows everything. Jesus knows everything. He knew what was going to happen. He put them in the boat. Where did Jesus go? He went up to the mountain to pray. He was up praying and seeking God. And now the disciples that were in the boat have been there for a while. And it says that now they were in the midst of the sea. And there began a storm to come. And it says in that storm that there was wind. There were waves tossing them back and forth. There was a lot of things going on. And they began to become fearful. And it says here, let's read that part. I'm going to just jump to the part where Jesus shows up. Let me see if I can find it real quick. I know I got to highlight it. And it says, excuse me. Okay. And it says, let me start in 24. It says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea. Jesus had put them in that boat. And it was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves for the wind was contrary. So now they're in the middle of that storm. Jesus had put them, had told them to get into the ship. And now they're there. There's a storm brewing. And they began to get scared. But it says here, in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And I love that part in the Bible where it says, on the fourth watch, he went walking on the sea. And so when I first saw that, I was like, oh, well, here's the four again. It's the four creations. The number four. We all know and we've been taught about those four images that we have to bear in us. But I looked up the fourth watch. And you think, so now we, you know, you have to, I love, with me, I like when I read the Bible, I paint a picture. It's like I'm painting a picture of how everything is described in the Bible. The disciples are in the boat. They're in the middle of the sea. There's a storm brewing. They become scared. They see Jesus. It's the fourth hour, fourth watch. The fourth watch is, the hours are from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. around that time. 3 a.m. is considered the devil's hour. It's the worst hour that there is. There's a lot of bad things, activity going on at that time. But you think about it, it says that Jesus appeared at the fourth watch. And so you think about that. When there's evil all around and there's darkness or storms all around, do you not know that Jesus can appear right at the right moment and he brings salvation, he brings healing, he brings restoration, he brings hope to you? We should never get caught up in those storms. But it says in that fourth watch, and you think about it, 3 a.m., that is what that hour is called. The fourth watch is from 3 a.m. to 6 a.m. 6 a.m. is considered dawn, and it's at the point at which it becomes possible to detect light. The sun is not risen yet, but you can detect that light is coming. And see, at that fourth watch, Jesus stepped in that water and he began to walk. He began to walk in the midst of the storm, and that light was coming to them. For Jesus is the light to all men. John 1 says that he is the light. Whenever there are troubles and things going on in your life, will you let that stop you from being passionate enough to step out of that situation? As Jesus came to them, he was walking to them. They saw him, and what did they do? They got scared. They didn't know it was Jesus. But it says here, I'm going to jump down to 27. It says, but straightway Jesus spake unto them and said, be of good courage. It is I. Be not afraid. He's telling them, don't be scared. It is me. It's Jesus coming to you. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water. Peter was passionate enough. Even though, and you think about it, where did Peter's discipleship start? Or when he followed Christ, what was he doing? He was gathering his net. He was a fisherman. He knew that you can't walk on water. What happened to make Peter come to Jesus and tell Jesus, bid me to walk on that water and I'll come to you? See, God is wanting you to step out into off that boat and step in faith and know that God, Jesus, the Holy Ghost will meet you. He stepped out and he said, and Peter answered and said unto him, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. That's all Jesus said. He said, come. Reminds me about when he called them. He said, follow me. And they had to leave everything and follow Jesus. He told him, come. And it says, and when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. He was passionate enough to ask Jesus, let me come to you. Although there's a storm brewing, although we're in the middle of the sea, although I know that I can't walk on that water, he had to cast all that down. He was moved with passion to get to him. What will you do to get close to Jesus? What will you do? What action will you take to show passion for the Lord? What will you do? If there's an altar call, would you run like there's no tomorrow and throw yourself at the altar just to be close to your master? Would you do that? Peter walked on that water. He took that step out of that boat and began to walk. But when he began to lose focus on Jesus, when he took his eyes off our master, when he began to see the storms brewing and all the waves crashing. See, you think about this. Let's paint this picture. When Jesus told him to come and walk on water, it never says there that the storm stopped. They were still in the middle of a storm, and it was dark because it was the fourth watch of the day. There was only a little bit of light creeping in. So it was dark. There was a storm. The wind was blowing. I'm sure it wasn't a peaceful boat just gliding on the water. That boat was rocking. But yet he did not let any of those elements stop him from taking that step off that boat onto that water and walking to Jesus. But when he lost focus, when he took his eyes off of Jesus, and he began to settle his thoughts on the wind, on the storm, on the ocean, on the water, on the wind, on all the elements that surrounded him, he lost focus and began to sink into that water. And Jesus had to reach out and save him. See, even when we mess up, even when we doubt, there's always that arm of hope. Yeah. Jesus reached out his arm and he said, oh, you of little faith, come with me. And he pulled them up on top of that water and they both walked together. And again, as they walked on that water, it never said that the storm ended. They were still walking in the midst of the storm until they got into the boat. And Jesus commanded the wind to stop. Then it stopped. Jesus commanded it to stop. He is our passion. We have to be passionate towards Him. What will you do to show that passion? What do you put in front of you that stops you from being passionate to the Lord? Passion is not just on a one moment, one day, just showing our church Wednesdays and Sundays. Being passionate means you're living for Christ daily. You're looking for that intimacy, looking to be one with Him, looking to be that bride to that bridegroom, seeking the Lord, crying out to Him, not letting anything get in your way. And see, this is where we need to focus. We need to be people that are very careful not to let little things come in our way and steal those moments with the Lord. I'm going to share this moment I had last night. As I was praying and studying and seeking the Lord, I was in my room by myself. And I was just so lost in worship. And I was studying and reading the Bible. And then I would lift up my hands and I was just worshiping the Lord. And Abel had Naya out of the room. So it was just me and the Lord by ourselves. And I have a desk and I have a business chair, office chair. And so with a high back. And so I'm there and I'm just seeking God and just crying out to Him. And as I'm seeking Him, I felt a hand on my back. I felt somebody press on my back. And I thought that maybe I had a sweater or jacket there and that it fell on me because I felt it. I mean, I felt something just gently press on my back. And so I turned and there's nothing there. And I thought, oh my gosh, I felt God. I felt the Lord touch me. He touched me. Do you not know in your moments of passion, in your moments that you get alone with God, in those moments where it's just you and Him, that He touches you, that He fills the room, that His presence is so powerful, yet so gentle, that it can sweep over your soul. Sometimes it's not in the loudness, it's not in the big rooms, but it's in those moments when we're alone, even those moments where maybe we have an issue and we don't know what to do. I encourage you, in those moments when you have those issues or you have something or you're going through something or you're feeling something, if you would just be passionate enough just to wait on Him, just to open up your vessel and let the presence of God fill the room. Fill the room, Lord. We ask You to fill the room, Father. We ask You, God, we cry out to You, God. Father, fill the room, Father, even right now, God. We want You to fill this room with Your presence. We want You, God, to fill this place with Your anointing and Your power. Oh, Father, we surrender everything to You, God. And we ask, God, that Your power, Your glory, Your anointing, Father, would even just fill this sanctuary. Oh, mandaraba shondara. Oh, Hallelujah. Stand up to your feet and just praise the Lord just for a minute. Oh, yes. Let that passion inside of you. Oh, it doesn't matter who's in the room. It doesn't matter if anybody touches me. All I want to do is cry out to the great I am. All I want to do is cry out to Jesus. Oh, for he's worthy. He's worthy to be praised. I pray. Oh, yes, as we approach this next year, even as we get ready in this year, it's going to be a different year. There's going to be many opportunities. There's going to be a lot of work to be done. Oh, do not ever let that work get before your passion. You have to have a passion to be one with the Lord. Oh, to marry that lamb, to have a relationship with him. Oh, don't let anything stop you. Don't let anything keep you from the love. Hallelujah. Don't be the description in Revelation where it says you forgot your first love. Don't ever forget that first love. And see, we have many loves in our life, but there's only one true love. There's only one. And he's the one that died on the cross for you. He's the one that paid the price so that you can have an opportunity to be made whole, to come close to God. Oh, yes, Lord, I praise you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Let that passion begin to rise up in us. Oh, we hunger for you, Lord. We hunger for you. Oh, yes, God. Oh, I praise your holy name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. I'm waiting on you, Lord. Oh, yes, have your way.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street, in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.